for your gifts to us, for the gift to see the beauty of spring, for the songs of birds migrating from their winter homes to build nests for their young, for the fragrance of flowers opening to the warm spring breezes, for the taste of the ripening fruit you provide for us, for the welcoming touch of a friend's hand. We thank you for the daylight to see the miracles of your creation here the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, the tumult of the peoples. Those who live at earth's farthest bounds are awed by your signs. You make the gateways of the morning and the evening about for joy. You visit the earth and water it. You greatly enrich it. The river of God is full of water. You provide the people with grain, for so you have prepared it. You water its furrows abundantly, settling its ridges, softening it with showers, and blessing its growth. You crown the year with your bounty. Your wagon tracks overflow with richness. The pastures of wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy.
We have been called to deny. Make me strong at the broken places. Yet when the dark night of the soul approaches, if it is possible, let that cup pass from me. But if not, amen. O God, you so love the world that you give and give and give the generous gift of life itself, freedom of choice, sunrise in the morning, sunset in the evening, and all the surprises in between. Then you give us all the time there is, eternity. I confess that my schedule often crowds out appreciation for these gifts, and my numbness allows me to take them for granted. Everyday living requires such a serious investment of my energy that I easily neglect the grandeur all around me. Set me free to dance to the rhythm of your spirit. Help me see that even times of sorrow and despair often enable me to discover the strength I never knew I had. Make me strong at the broken places. Yet when the dark night of the soul approaches, if it is possible, let that cup pass from me. But if not, for there were about 5,000 men. And he said to his disciples, "Make them sit down in groups of about 50 each." They did so and made them all sit down. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke them and gave them to the disciples to set before the crowd. And all ate and were filled. What was left over was gathered up, 12 baskets of broken pieces. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, so lots of things we can talk about here. Probably lots of things you have talked about in your life regarding this passage. I think most of us are familiar with it and similar ones like it. But let's go with the mindset here of God will provide. So Jesus sends his disciples out to perform miracles, but he doesn't allow them to take anything with them. No food, no clothes, no money. They're just going to hope that that works out for them. And in that culture, they would, right? Today, it'd be kind of weird if you were just like, "Hi, I'm here, feed me." I'd be like, "What are you here to steal from my house?" but they're told to rely on the people they meet to take them in, and that works, right? Because we don't hear that it didn't, so presumably when they come back to Jesus, if it hadn't worked, they would have been like, "You sent us out here, and it was bad." So the disciples go out, they heal people, return to Jesus, who then himself heals people, and the crowd following him. So at the end of the day, the disciples tell Jesus, "Well, it's time to follow the pattern that we've been following, right? And seek hospitality in the surrounding community." They completely trust at this point that God will now provide for this crowd, just as he has been providing for them. But Jesus tells the disciples, "No, you give them something to eat. You provide hospitality to all these people." Imagine how confused they must have been when they looked down and were like, "We have 5 loaves of bread, and there are 5,000 men." Right? 5,000 men means innumerable women and children that would have traveled with these men, right? What are they supposed to do? And if it's me, why does it have to me to figure it out? Like, Jesus, you are the Son of God, and God provides. I don't understand. So let's leave the story there. I know there's a lot of other things that we can talk about, but let's shift to frugality. What is it? Is it, I thought it just meant like, people who are kind of cheap, don't when the disciples listened to Jesus' instructions to gather, seat, and feed the crowd, that could be seen as the discipline of frugality, right? They have shut off everything else in order to focus on what Jesus there in front of them is saying. So they don't hoard the food for themselves. They don't focus on their own needs. Instead, they're focused on Jesus. The end result is that Jesus is able to use his disciples, his followers, to take care of everyone, which could be us, right? If you practice this discipline of frugality, focus on what Jesus has called us to do, not only will you yourself be taken care of, but you can be used to take care of others. So are we supposed to give up everything? Give up all your food and all your money? I mean, you can if you want. I'm sure there are people out there who need it and would take it, but I don't think that's what we're being asked to do here. This frugality is a discipline, a way of focusing your mind. And I think through practicing this discipline of frugality, we're training ourselves to focus on what's important, just as Jesus did with his disciples, right? Training them. If we do this, then not only will we be provided for, but can be a part of providing for others. So to me, what's important in all of this